So good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. Namrata. I'll be taking the didactic for today, and the topic for today's didactic is Neurobiology of Nicotine Addiction. So in the previous cases, we have seen certain things related to this. For example, the first case they were mentioning about the very early age of onset. Dr. Saraswati mentioned that he just tried once and then after that started using it very regularly. And here in this case, as I mentioned, the anxiety along with tobacco, whether it is related. So we'll be covering some of these things in today's session. So these are the objectives for today's presentation. Basically, we will be learning about the reward pathway, which basically functions for all the drugs of abuse, and what are the different areas of the brain involved in addiction per se, and the mode of delivery of nicotine, how it reaches the brain, and what are the implications of that. The specific aspects of nicotine addiction, what makes nicotine different from the other drugs of abuse and how it is more addictive than the other substances, and what are the effects of nicotine in the on the receptors in the brain, and what are the clinical implications of knowing this neurobiology. So the first question which arises is, nicotine addiction possible? Because a lot of your patients will never admit to the fact that they're addicted to smoking or addicted to tobacco or nicotine. So the answer to this very obviously is yes, nicotine addiction is very much possible. In fact, it is amongst the most addictive drugs, and there is no other psychoactive drug which affects the receptors or the chemistry of the brain as much as nicotine. And as you can see in this bar graph, if the number of users is kept common in all of them, the percentage addicted is much more for tobacco compared to other drugs like alcohol, cocaine or heroin. So the if they are using for the same duration of time, then the addiction percentage is much more for tobacco. So the trajectory of the tobacco use follows any other substance of abuse. That is, they use tobacco, they get addicted, it leads to complications, death. And sometimes if they stop, if they manage to stop, the health improves. And if they relapse, again goes back to the same vicious cycle. So initially we will discuss about addiction per se. What is the neurobiology of addiction? And then later progress to specific aspects about nicotine. So the reward pathway is basically the hub which is causing this addiction. So we'll know a little bit about a reward pathway. So it is an axonal network which is located in the limbic system of the brain, which the function of it is to monitor the homeostasis, and it also manages the memory and learning and how a person experiences emotion. The different areas of the brain included in this limbic system is the hypothalamus, amygdala, hippocampus, nucleus accumbens, the ventral tegmental area, locus coeruleus, and prefrontal cortex. These areas are important as we'll be dealing with the function of each of these areas separately later on. So this reward pathway is activated commonly by anything which you like to do, basically. So as a person likes to eat food, your favorite food will activate this reward pathway. You feel good, so you want to eat that food again. Water, sex, or activities such as skydiving, paragliding, or anything which you're enjoying basically activates this reward pathway, and you want to do it again. Similarly, exercise. So interesting part here is that these drugs of abuse also activate this reward pathway. So you can understand why a person would want to do it again. So the dopamine is the main neurotransmitter associated with this reward pathway. And like any other drug of abuse, nicotine also stimulates this brain reward pathway and increases the dopamine. So this is the main pathway of dopamine, that is from ventral tegmental area to nucleus accumbens. It's called the mesolimbic pathway. Apart from this, there is a very important role for the prefrontal cortex as well. The other areas of the brain involved here would be, the frontal cortex, which is basically related to planning and decision taking and judgment and, strategizing what a person wants to do. The nucleus accumbens and ventral tegmental area, as I mentioned, it is the mesolimbic pathway for dopamine. And the locus coeruleus, amygdala and hippocampus, these are associated with forming memories. So a person smokes or uses tobacco, how is that memory formed? If a person is smoking, they are feeling good, so they form a memory of this response to that smoking. The amygdala adds an emotional aspect to this memory, and hippocampus retains that memory. Apart from dopamine, there is also a role for glutamate, which is again one of the neurotransmitters. So the amygdala, hippocampus and frontal cortex, they communicate with the reward pathway with the use of glutamate. So there is an increase in the release of glutamate, and this glutamate in turn increases the dopamine release. And this link is strengthened with every use. This link keeps getting strengthened. The dopaminergic pathway and the release of glutamate and the signaling to off the glutamate to release more dopamine. This pathway keeps on getting strengthened with each use and leads to long-term potentiation. That is, these synapses keep getting stronger and stronger with each use. So as I mentioned, the prefrontal cortex, not only is it involved in just decision making and the cognitive processing, it is also related to the initial vulnerability of a person to use drugs. And repeated use of a drug will gradually decrease the dopaminergic receptors in the striatum, and it will activate the reward pathway even more. And this underperformance of the prefrontal system is a crucial part of being addicted to a substance, as it also leads to inability to delay gratification. So we have learned till now that there are four different parts and four different circuits which are involved with this nicotine addiction. One is the reward pathway, which mainly involves the ventral tegmental area and the nucleus accumbens in the limbic system. The other is the inhibitory control, that is decision making, whether I should or should not use, and inhibiting that response to use, that is the prefrontal cortex. Another area is the orbitofrontal cortex and the anterior cingulate gyrus, which drives this, your need to use this substance, and it creates that motivation to use the substance. And last but not the least is the extended amygdala and the hippocampus, which creates a memory of the previous substance use, because of which a person wants to use that again. So this is how this link keeps getting strengthened with each use. Initially, the mesolimbic dopaminergic pathway releases dopamine, you feel good. Then it goes to the dorsal striatum, which wants you to keep using. It creates a compulsive behavior to keep using, and if you do not use, it leads to withdrawal. Then the amygdala forms memories of the previous use, because of which you want to use again. Now coming to specific aspects of nicotine addiction. So the mode of delivery, it's different, of course, for oral tobacco use and for cigarette smoking. But for each cigarette, approximately it releases about 10 milligrams of nicotine. And the bioavailability of this is 10 to 40%. Therefore, if every time a person smokes one cigarette, it gives you 1 to 3 milligrams of nicotine per cigarette. Apart from the nicotine, there is, I think all of you already know that there is tar and there's carbon monoxide, which are products of the pyrolysis. That is, the burning of tobacco releases these products. The particles of the smoke through the cigarette, which enter your lung, the size range is around 1 micron or even smaller than 1 micron. So how is this nicotine delivered to your brain? So a person inhales the smoke coming from a cigarette. This smoke contains the tobacco and the nicotine. So the nicotine is distilled from the tobacco, and it is carried in these smoke particles into the lungs. From the lungs, it is absorbed into the pulmonary venous circulation. From here, it goes to the arterial circulation, then follows the nicotine diffusion into the brain tissue. Once it reaches the brain tissue, it binds the nicotinic acetylcholine receptors. These are the main receptors responsible for the mechanism of action of nicotine. So there are multiple subtypes of this receptor. There are five different subtypes, and there are different subunits of each receptor. That is, there are alpha and beta. In alpha, there are 9 different subunits. In beta, there are 3 different subunits. But the one important for us here is the alpha 4 beta 2 subtype, which the nicotine binds to, mainly in the ventral tegmental area of the brain. Once it is bound to this receptor, the channels will open, and it will allow the entry of the cations, and the whole function begins. So this nicotine binds to the alpha 4 beta 2 nicotine acetylcholine receptors in the ventral tegmental area. This releases dopamine. As I previously mentioned, the dopaminergic pathway responsible for reward is the ventral tegmental area to the nucleus accumbens. So it will release the dopamine in the nucleus accumbens, which leads to the reward or satisfaction which is associated with smoking. So related to this, I just wanted to share one experiment which was done. So I mentioned that there are so many different subunits or subtypes of the receptor. So it was seen that if the beta 2 subunit gene itself was eliminated or knocked out from a mouse, then the behavioral effects of nicotine were eliminated, which includes self-administration. So there have been multiple experiments where self-administration of the mice was seen. So this knocking out of the beta 2 subunit gene eliminates that behavior. And reinsertion of this beta 2 subunit gene again restores the behavioral response to nicotine. And there is another subunit that is alpha 4 beta 2, right? So alpha 4 subunit is responsible for the sensitivity of a person to nicotine. So they were seen that mutations in this alpha 4 part was responsible for increased or decreased sensitivity to nicotine induced reward behaviors, which also includes tolerance and sensitization. So another aspect here for a person to continue using nicotine is the reinforcement which they get from nicotine. So as I mentioned, the dopamine is basically responsible for pleasurable experiences. So once dopamine is released, you feel good. So it basically gives you that pleasure or feel good factor from any substance. So this is crucial for any reinforcing effect. So if, for example, even if a person is given some praise or they get some academic achievement, somebody's got a gold medal, that gives you a feel good feeling that you feel good and you want to do it again. That also involves dopamine. Similarly for substance of use. So it was seen that in these rats, these dopaminergic neurons in the brain were there was a lesion created there. Then the nicotine self-administration was reduced. That is, the rats chose not to use nicotine if this dopamine was knocked out. Similarly, for intracranial self-stimulation, it was seen. And apart from this, nicotine withdrawal is associated with significant increase in intracranial self-stimulation reward threshold. That is, once withdrawal sets in, there is an increase in self-administration of nicotine. Apart from this pleasurable effect, there are also certain conditioned stimuli. That is, the smell and the taste of the smoke, along with some other environmental cues. That is, you have company to smoke with you, or there is a place where you like to smoke. So even those environmental cues play an important part here to sustain this addictive pattern of cigarette smoking. So can anybody tell that how quickly does addiction develop? Dr. Vishal is very right. So it's the first dose of nicotine, that is the first cigarette, which leads to all these neurological changes in your brain and can make you addicted to this, to smoking or to using nicotine. That was the correct answer, Dr. Vishal. We'll see now, why does this happen? Why is it that for other substances, it's different, and for nicotine, just one dose of nicotine, that is just one cigarette, can make create so many changes in your brain. So the nicotine from one cigarette occupies 88% of the brain's nicotinic receptors. So there is something called brain receptor occupancy, which is important for any drug which we use. So it occupies 88% of the nicotinic receptors, that is just from one cigarette. And this nicotine changes the transcription of hundreds of genes in the brain with the first use. And the first use itself initiates drug sensitization and upregulation of the nicotinic receptors in the brain. That is, one dose stimulates an increase in number of receptors overnight. Another aspect here is faster delivery of free nicotine. It is known that free nicotine is easily carried rather than bound nicotine. So free nicotine is easily absorbed compared to bound nicotine. And there is a faster delivery of free nicotine. So as the pH increases, the nicotine changes its chemical form so that it is more rapidly absorbed by the body and gives a kick to the smoker. Another aspect here is blood nicotine concentration. So the nicotine concentration fluctuates widely throughout the day, beginning at lower levels after sleeping. So during the sleep, the levels of nicotine drop down. That is why people don't usually wake up in the middle of night to smoke, but it rises throughout the day. And it is seen that it is strongest early in the morning, the craving, because the blood nicotine concentration is the lowest in the early morning. So waking is accompanied by early signs of withdrawal with stronger cravings in more dependent smokers. That's why most of your patients, if you see, they will tell that as soon as they wake up, they need a smoke. Another aspect here is nicotine receptor modulation, which happens with even a single dose of nicotine, that the nicotine receptors upregulate. What happens here is, once you are using nicotine, the number of receptors for nicotine which bind this, so we mentioned alpha 4 beta 2 nicotine receptor, right? So these increase in number. So to satisfy those increased number of receptors, you need more nicotine, and you need it on more regular basis. So earlier, for example, if there were 100 receptors and they were being satisfied by just one cigarette, the next time you use it, like after maybe 2 or 3 days, the 100 will multiply into 200. And then you obviously need 2 cigarettes. Similarly, it keeps increasing with continued use, and you will keep on wanting more and more nicotine in your body to satisfy these receptors. Then there is latency. Latency is basically the time from using one, finishing your first cigarette and then wanting another one. So this time, this latency period keeps on decreasing with regular use. So at the onset of addiction, it may be longer than a week. So a person uses a smoke and then they want maybe another one they'll want after a week or so. But with regular use, this latency keeps shortening and you want to use it more repeatedly and more frequently. This is what I was explaining basically. This is the regular homeostasis. The brain wants basically homeostasis, balance. That there are equal number of receptors, there is equal number of compound which is satisfying those. It remains okay. But what happens with continuous nicotine use is the receptors adapt. There is neuroadaptation which occurs in response to nicotine. So if you see, if there is no nicotine, then the weight on the adaptation, that is the number of receptors, will go down. And then there will be craving. The scale will move to the craving and the craving will start. Once you get back that nicotine, it will come back to your balance and your brain will work normally. It will say that, okay, now I'm fine because the balance is maintained. Again, you stop smoking, the nicotine is removed. Again, this adaptation, the increased number of receptors start irritating you and they'll be like, okay, I want more. And then again, this nicotine will come and it will create a balance. So this is what happens with regular nicotine use. So we are coming to the end of this presentation. You can always ask questions after this presentation. So then what we've learned till now is that nicotine rewires the brain to produce addiction. There is a change in the receptors, there is neuromodulation, there is neuroadaptation, there's a change in the dopaminergic pathways, the prefrontal cortex. All this leads to a change in the brain which leads to addiction and which starts with just one dose. And the core of addiction here lies in the reward pathway, which we previously mentioned, ventral tegmental area and the nucleus accumbens. And the problems with the frontal cortex, which impairs your decision-making ability, the amygdala and the hippocampus, which connects your emotions to your memory, and it creates long-term potentiation and forms a strong memory of your substance use, which makes you want to use it again. There is desensitization of the receptors. There is receptor upregulation, which leads to craving and withdrawal symptoms in the future. The nicotine addiction here is not just because of the positive reinforcement, which is given by the effect of nicotine, but also the conditioned stimuli, like the environmental cues, the smell, taste of cigarette, and also in order to avoid the negative consequences of withdrawal. So a person learns with just the first experience of withdrawal that this withdrawal is very unpleasant and I do not want to experience this withdrawal again. So some people continue to smoke just to avoid that withdrawal symptoms. Some people may continue to use for that positive pleasurable effect. And some people may continue to use because they like just that environment or the ambience of the smoking. So what are the clinical implications here? Obviously, on pharmacotherapy, that we use the drugs which are either replacing nicotine in the brain or they stimulate similar nicotinic effects in the brain, because of which a person, the withdrawal symptoms comes down and the person does not want it again. So we can use nicotine replacement, which basically replaces the nicotine, and we can use other drugs like alpha 4 beta 2 partial agonists like vernicline, which this is a drug which is available, which acts on the very alpha 4 beta 2 subtype of nicotine receptors. And apart from that, there are dopamine reuptake inhibitors, which will basically, even if you're using nicotine, you will not get that pleasurable effect from nicotine because of which you would not want to continue it. Depends on case-to-case basis, which person is using for what reason. That is very important. If you know if a person is using for the sake of pleasure, if a person is using it to avoid the withdrawal effects, the negative effects, as I mentioned in the previous case, are they using because they're anxious? Is it relieving their anxiety because of which they're using nicotine continuously? Or are there any other reasons, whether it is just peer pressure? So based on the reason for continued nicotine use, you can try for your pharmacotherapy or your psychological interventions. Thank you so much.